Thank you. Make her a permanent judge. The offer is former of life. This morning it comes to you. You have very hard to hold it on. Lord, human words cannot sometimes comfort our soul. Those for me need your help. Your Father that comforts and strengthens those who mourn. This morning we need your favor, we need your guidance, we need your mercy and grace. Today guide us, but as we reflect on the life of my mama and the faithfulness you showed upon her, the race that she ran, and we know that she is with you. Your faithful God, we not only guide our life in this world, but give us eternal hope. Today, Lord, help us to have the assurance and understanding that one day we will see her face to face. And that day we will rejoice in your presence with her. Well, today, meanwhile, as we reflect upon the life, help us to understand how we need to carry on the torch she has given to us. Lord, teach us and guide us today. We give the rest of the service into your hand. Be glorified in this place. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Let us be seated.
Thank you. Thank you.
So have this to the maximum of pain for us. So as I was thinking about what she meant to me and Anne, I was reminded of the book of Bible study a few weeks gone, and I know my mother is not wanting to end up some sad problems or sentiments, and she never let such things drive about her decisions, but I think she would allow them one exception this time. And rising up on a book like this, if I ever hang on the highest tower, I know who's God would call me this day. If I ever drown in the deepest sea, I know whose tears have come to me. If I ever damned the body and soul, I know whose prayers have made me whole. Mother of mine and God of mine. So she gave the all to Anna and I, but more than that, she provided me with an example how to find one explaining by life, one explaining the world by living in the life, irrespective of the circumstances and challenges one faces. And for that, we are truly grateful and we will miss it all our lives.
She would shake her head and claim that her grandchildren and children loved her more than us because they were the only her guardian. I always remember we would argue back. We don't even have grandchildren, so we don't know where your grandchildren are. But she really didn't care. Needless to say, we would always end up with children. When she began to have problems with her even after the initial surgery, the family would go to her each year at Christmas, at Christmas time, to get another surgery, a corrective surgery, and to be surgery. Each time, she would shake her head, saying that she would only get the surgery if her mother, one of her grandchildren, grew up and became a surgeon, and they performed it themselves. Amma never kept presents. A few years ago during the holidays, Amma put his eye in a computer box. In the box was 6 years worth of presents that I had given him. She insisted that I keep them. At first, I thought it was because she didn't like the berries. Later, however, after finding out that everything happened to Surrey and the weekend, I realized that it was just how long it was. The only gift that she never knew about to me was a candle that I gave her on Christmas. The rest of the offer has been given for 7 years. Sifting through all of these memories of Amma, it's hard to think of the words exactly what she meant to us as a girl. She was moved as our people fighting. We made her such an incredible and powerful figure in our lives. We're not just her with her power, but furthermore with the impact that she had on each of us. She was more than a grandmother. She was a mother figure. She raised for that she prepared us as babies and all the way through. She was a role model of resilience and faith. She was the matriarch of our family. She had the ability to unite villages from every corner of the globe. And most people were like, what did you guys have to do this day? She was our rock. There's a Hebrew proverb that says, "Say not in grief, she is no more, but through the thankfulness that she was." It is Amma's unmatched strength and the unbreakable will that she displayed throughout her life that we are so unbelievably blessed to have experienced. That in his words and values that she would live her life with, both forever and present in her life. Even if her physical presence will not, never will always be enough. I think I speak on behalf of all four of her grandchildren when I say that Amma has and always will be one of the most, if not the most, influential people in our life. We may not always finish all the meals that she would bring us to food. We may not all be good doctors. One thing is for sure, we will live our lives with these same qualities that made Amma the amazing grandmother and human being that she was, and we will make her proud. Thank you for everything, Amma. We love you forever. Now that your hearts be troubled, trusting God must also be me. In my Father's house there are many rooms, but the word I tell, I will tell you. I am going to prepare a place for you, and if I don't prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you as if you may be ready. You know the way to the place I am going. Second reading is from Romans 8:37-40. Now in all these things, we have all the confidence in him who is with us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, the angels nor demons, in the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God who is in Christ Jesus.
this today. And we have gathered here to give our tribute to our loving mom, to celebrate the life. I'm the pastor of the Mobile Harvest Church. She was one of our pioneering members in our church. And this is our first funeral in our church also. And it's a very meaningful and dear to our heart. And we take it as I take it as a great honor and a privilege to share this special day. As we were reflecting upon Mama's life, many emotions, yes, spraying, asking God, God, what do I need to share? Mama had a little bit of an amazing journey, remarkable works, went through challenges in life. But in spite of all the challenges, she had a greater hope and a greater faith. Looking at the hearing of the stories and looking at the lives of the children and grandchildren, it amazes me how God's grace leads us and guides us. It reminds me of the scripture from the Bible, Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 2-4. Here, the great wise man, he's called King Solomon. The world called one of the wisest men who ever lived in this world, based on there. After experiencing great victories, enjoying and tasting life, he probably wrote this book at the end of his life. He says, what is man gains by all the toil, and which he toils under the sun? A generation goes and a generation comes, but the earth remains forever. He's reflecting about the life he went through. He's a man who had great experiences. He experiences great wealth in his life. He had great desire for life. Wealth and strength came and abounded for him. Well, after the later passage, if you read it, he talks about it in his life. For laughter, he had great wine. And for military power, he had so much power and wealth, security in his life. He had all the strength and wealth. He had maids, concubines, and everything. But end of the day, when he comes to see his life, he says, meaningless. It comes for a moment and passes on. Then he writes in chapter 3, the book of Ecclesiastes, says, for everything there is a season, a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck. But what is planted? A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to rejoice. This special day, as while we were looking at the life of Mama, let us reflect upon our life. Let us search our heart. Where are we in life? Here he's talking about time. Today, time has come for us, brought us to this place. We all have time in our life. Time brought us to cradle. At a certain time, we all, time will face the time, we will face the death. As Amma has seen the past week. But one thing is certain, how are we going to spend the time and how we are going to, how it implies in our life? Let us take a moment. Sometimes we are so busy, caught up with our own thing in our life. Life is like we will be just doing mundane things, getting caught up with the busyness of life, and we forget There's a season. This season in this earth is going to end. There's a season for everything. Sometimes, because we are so much busy and so much involved in the world, or the worries of the world, we even forget there's a time involved for us. Today we are going to look at the time. There are three things about the time. One is, time is constant. Time is given for everybody. Whether you're rich or poor, time is given for all of us. It's not partial to anybody. Second, time cannot be saved. We all have given time. We cannot save our time for tomorrow just because we are busy today. Every minute has certain seconds. Every hour has certain minutes. Every day has certain hours. Whether we use it or we lose it. So time comes. One time to the president, Roosevelt, they asked, what time? He said this way. They asked him, how can you save time? He says, if you want to save time, use it wisely. Today, my brothers and sisters, we are in crossroads to look at our life. How are we spending our time? How is our life? Where is it taking us? Is it being spent meaningfully? Third truth about the time is precious. It is so precious. Nothing can be compared to that. A young student recently, a medical student, I observed his life and I asked him a question. What is your goal? And he was so busy working, doing things in his life. So well focused. Had a great ambition. I asked him, what is your goal after you finish your college? I want to be a great surgeon, he said. And then I said, what is next? He said, after I finish my surgical schooling and all these things, I want to go to Mayo Clinic and I want to get the best expertise in my specialty of my area. So what is next? I want to get a great job. I want to finish it, get a good job and make a lot of money. And then what do you want to go to do with that money? When I make money, I also want to give it to the community. I have a great family. I have a great people who have helped me thus far. So what is next? Maybe I'll get married. Great. So what is next after you get married? Maybe I'll have children. What is next after you have children? Well, I'll probably get old with it. And what is next after that? Maybe I might die. He said, my friend, not maybe you will die. We will all die one day. What is next after death? Well, because I haven't thought much about it. We spend so much time spending our effort and efficiency in preparing ourselves on this side of the death, on this side of the grave. Sometimes we don't think about what happens after. Brown Lyman is a great man of God who told me once, we are spiritual beings. We are not a human being having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. Life God made us for eternity. Today we are gathered here. Yes, we are mourning for us. Departure. Grieving. Because Allah is so beloved to us. When I think about it, I was sharing with our family, church family, that the word she says, she comforts us, she calls us, we miss that so much. But she has graduated, she is in a better place today. As I was looking at the one thing, Lord, how can I be comforted by this? I was thinking about it. Then I remembered that from the scripture, the prophet, 2,000 years ago, prophets and great men of God, the one of God called, this man is greater than the King Solomon, is the Jesus Christ. He said something. He said, In Matthew chapter 16, verse 26, for what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? But what shall a man give in return for his soul? Our soul returns back. We are made for eternity. Our spirit lives on forever. God has given us a greater hope. That's why while he was on this earth, there is a great wise man and a religious man who cared for the community. He was living a good religious life. He came. There's something spectacular about this man called Jesus. He's a man of wisdom and understanding. He came, his name called Nicodemus, and he came to Jesus. And he said, Jesus, what should I do to inherit the kingdom of God? Or you can call it, what should I do to inherit the eternal life? Jesus said to him, if you want to inherit the kingdom of God, in John chapter 3, verse 3, it says that Jesus answered him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Immediately, Nicodemus, he was a very knowledgeable man, said, Jesus, let's be practical here. He's pretty old. How can I go back to my mother's home? Be born again. Jesus said, I'm not talking about the physical birth. I'm talking about the spiritual birth. Unless you're born in the spirit, unless you're forgiven, your sins are forgiven, unless you don't have faith in the God Almighty, you cannot have the forgiveness of sin. Unless that's what born again means, restored being is transformed. Nicodemus immediately grasped that message. Today, God wants us to have that eternal hope also. While I was with Allah, I had many conversations. I was a bachelor. I had a great deal of time to take her, pick her up, and travel with her to the church. And we sent out all of them. We have two grandmas. One of them, yesterday I'm sitting here for 5 minutes. I don't drop them off, put them back. On this journey, I've never seen Amma complain about anybody. She always encouraged me and strengthens me. We get a lot of theological debate. Amma comes from the Catholic background, I come from the Protestant background, but regardless of background, we joyfully share our discussions. And she asked me the same question, son, how can I have the assurance that I will enter the kingdom of God? So we discussed about this. And she obeyed the call and she asked Jesus into her life. The great joy of the Lord overflowed her life beyond measures. She was a caring mother. That great gave me great strength and she was a great role model to me also. That today, I want to tell you, if you know something about Amma, Amma didn't leave this earth with grief. She left this earth with greater hope and joy and peace. I was there that day, a few minutes after she passed away. I took a friend from South Africa. As soon as he saw my situation, he realized it's a great peace. Comfort and strength and confidence in our brothers and sisters, friends and families, do you have the confidence that you will face eternity with God and the hope of heaven? I want to share a few things about Amma's life, how the revival touched my life. Amma, in spite of her challenges and the experiences she gave, she really comforted many every time we encounter people. And there are many stories I can share, but because of the time factor, I'm going to make it brief. I'm, as I said, I used to give her a ride every week. And she begged in a few days, every Wednesday and Saturday, she makes food for the pastor. I really enjoyed it. They were the real few number of people. She made dedicated food. Not only any food she made my favorite food. She asked me, Marina, what do you want? I love her idea. She made the idea. She works hard and she does a great job. Yeah, so I love to see her by any time. She's here. Even though I was so thousands of miles away from my biological parents, I'm up in an amazing role in my life. One day we were coming back after dropping up everybody. And she said, son, I want to stop at a gas station. We want to go to a gas station. You don't drive. So there is a jackpot, $1 million jackpot. Come on, I'm a pastor. No? Well, you know what? If I'm blessed, you are going to be blessed, and many people are going to be blessed. So I said, well, then you can lose your pastor. So I went to partner today. She is amazing. They have an amazing heart. It's a joy. And this surpasses just so many difficulties we face that helps us to overgo or go forward the greater things. And there are many things I wrote, but I'm going to make it short here. It's amazing how in our church, when I'm up 1 and 6 in the back row, there are children always, we see commotion in that area. So one day I went to the back of that area. Why does kids doesn't want to come and sit in the front row? Why are they hanging out in the back row? Then I pulled one kid and said, what is the problem with you? Why are you guys sitting in the back? Well, we are waiting there on the side. They're in the back, you know? She always, because of the age range, she found a way to connect with people. And our young to the seniors, they love the mother. What an amazing, amazing person. And then, in the middle of the time, before she passed away, the strength she showed, she never talked about her problems. She always talked about others. She put others first. She asked what everybody else is going to say. She wanted to pray for them. Today, we are not here to say goodbye to Mom. We are gathered here to say, we'll see you soon. But God has promised us, those who are in Christ, the hope beyond this life, that one day we will reunite. Some of you might say, parents, I don't want this guarantee. Today, and you believe in Jesus Christ, the same guarantee of tomorrow's seed, you can have it in Jesus Christ. The hope of eternity. I want to close with one scripture. In John chapter 3, verse 16, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his son. Whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Today I'm going to enter into the eternal eternity. Now the question is, where are you? I pray that we can confidently say, while today is not a goodbye to you, we'll see you soon. Our Savior. Thank you for this opportunity. God bless you. Thank you.
This deep sense of religious fervor was born out of several reasons too long ago to hear, but I know attending daily mass for her younger years in Javelin set her on the path to exceptional faith. Alma had a family. Alma had 8 siblings, 20 nephews and nieces, and countless grandnephews and nieces, not to mention her 2 children and her 4 grandchildren. If you saw me in the slideshow earlier, all her grandchildren were a pride and joy. Her nephews and nieces were a close second. When she first moved in with us, I sat down with her when we got our first Quest communication to build. It was $337. And she looked at me like I had a problem when I was showing her calls to Sri Lanka for $47, and Germany for $31, and Australia for $52. People just found their way to gather when she was in town. I know Sandra was saying a little bit of that. Parties sprouted up around her, but she wasn't really a partying type. Having this sense of family was a great joy for her, but it was also a burden. She buried several of her siblings. She planned funerals for some of her nephews who had untimely deaths as well. She continued to hold that spot as the respected matriarch of her family. And she acted upon, people listened to what she had to say and acted upon what she asked them to do. I once heard my sister-in-law Liz call her a force of nature, and I think that was aptly put. Alma and her cinema. Not a widely known fact, that Alma was an extreme movie buff. She used to go to the cinema in town back in Jaffna, even telling her mother who would watch her children that she had a poor play. She even traveled up to India at one point with a colleague to visit a movie set of Sivaji, one of the famous Indian actors. This was in the early 1970s, and rumor has it that because they looked a little different, their sarees were different, they were clearly out of towners. They invited her on the movie set, and she actually got to meet the actors of Sivaji. It's interesting that for the most part of the U.S., she actually shunned movies as a waste of time. But in the end, she kind of came full circle and watched her son TV and entertainment movies. Alma and frugality, or another way of putting it, selfless giving. Alma's focus on stretching the dollar was infuriating at times. If you ever met Raj Daly with her, you don't know what I mean. She would haggle an even older white woman down from $3 to $1.50 on the purse, and then she would turn around and ask Ann and I to spend $30 to send him overseas to sign it. If you know what big gifting means, Alma took that to a new level. When she got a gift from somebody, as Sandra mentioned, she had in mind already who was going to receive that gift from her. But she didn't take the credit, she gave credit where credit was due. The only items in her early cap that I saw her keep were usually groceries and chocolates, entirely selfless. If you ever picked up the mama from the airport, or Sylvia and I were talking about the other night, she was always overweight on her suitcases. You'd show up to pick her up, and the handle would really break out of your hand as you're picking up the suitcases. But after you got over the hernia surgeries, it was very hard to stay mad at her. I've never seen a person stretch by dollars as far as she could and make so many people's face light up in the process. There were countless orphanages, pastors, and poor families that benefited from Alma's generosity that she never met in her life. I'll wrap up by asking you to think of your name for a minute. What's in a name? How many names do you have or are you called by? Most of us have a first name, you might have a nickname or called by. When she first moved in with us, one of the first calls we had, somebody asked, is Kate Mommy there? Well, it turns out it's a person she had made cakes for before, and so that's how that name referred to her. And then the next call was, is Nella there? The next call was Arkachi, then Kangat, then Amma, then Miriam, then Mariana. And if you think about all these people, what these names meant to those individuals, all terms of endearments exhibiting what she meant to everyone from their perspective. I can only imagine her in heaven right now being called by so many different souls she touched over the years who have passed. She must be in heaven. Universally, she was on mom, her mother, nurturing, caring, selfless. You will be missed. God has a special place for you. And one of her favorite prayers, she used to say, I'm the day, kingdom of man, and kingdom of man. Thank you.
Walking in, there's an elevator right here. You can take out of here as well.
About approximately 1:15, the family began to gather to turn out to Northfield for the middle service. I'm all in the lead and trying to follow their stoplights and everything. And they between Farmington and Northfield, we can all catch up. Those were going. Directions are a little tricky in Northfield, but from here we're going to go Cedar to 160th South, I don't know, 46, and go east then to Highway 3, and then down to Northfield. And if you need more directions, the field director will be walking around here in the luncheon and will give you specifics on how to get from downtown Northfield to 270th, with Carlton College and Wall Street, that's Oklahoma Cemetery. We'll close then with a prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. There's so many versions we put on the screen here for us. So let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction. As you go on your way, may God go with you. May he go before you to show you the way. May he go behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, and within you to give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.